Hello everybody, I'm Iannone and welcome to the Sports Reel. And today, I come to bring a warning to all of the sports fans in the audience. You see, there's a particular type of movie out there that preys upon our love of sports. These are movies that promise to give us lots of sports action, but in fact, they are romantic comedies! Such is the case with today's movie, The Main Event. Released in 1979, it should have been obvious from the start that this would be a romantic comedy when the top-billed star in this movie that is supposedly about boxing is none other than Barbra Streisand. Let me repeat that. A boxing movie starring Barbra Streisand. Not Sylvester Stallone, not Denzel Washington, not Hugh Jackman and a bunch of Rock'em Sock'em robots, Barbra Streisand. Do you think this movie will have any redeeming qualities? If you said yes, get some help. The rest of you can stay here with me as we suffer through the main event. We open on what appears to be some people talking about, drugs?
Put it on the street.
No.
Mm-hmm. That's what I heard.
I love it in its pure form.
Oh, don't you think they should dilute it just a little?
Well, of course they'll have to. It's so strong.
Very high quality.
Ha ha ha, they made you think they were talking about drugs, but it was really just perfume. But wait, they were talking about it like it was about to be sold on the streets. What is this, black market perfume?
I want every kid in the world hooked on Eau de Toilette!
So we see that Barbra is playing Hillary Kramer, co-owner of a perfume company, and her boys in the lab have just created what should be her next bestseller.
I swear, there's an orgy going on inside my nose.
Well, it's certainly big enough to host an orgy.
They don't call you the nose for nothing.
Oh, I see what you're trying to do here, movie. You knew this day would come. You knew the day would come when an internet reviewer would make fun of you, so you try to make the nose jokes easy to make it look like I'm being lazy. Well, you know what? I'm not gonna give in. So no more jokes about Barbra Streisand's nose the rest of the way. So Hillary goes to her office to discuss the new product with her employees, but her secretary keeps trying to get her attention.
Hillary!
Now what we have to do is market this thing properly because it's the 1 cent...
Hillary!
What?
David says it's important!
Okay, you don't have to yell like that. Put him on hold. Tell him I'll be right there. Where was I?
In a market with 1 cent.
Yeah, in a market with 1 cent. Okay, this perfume is the only scent that we can market that way. Why? Because it's the only scent that a man can buy for a woman. A man can buy for another man. A woman can buy for a man. A woman can buy for another woman. Isn't that fantastic? Have I left anybody out?
Oh my God, shut up! Good God, they are so annoying. It's like they're trying to squeeze as much dialogue as possible into a 3-minute scene. Hillary gets a call from her ex-husband, who's also her lawyer. Funny. He tells her that he needs to meet with her, but she tells him she has an important meeting to attend.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, and 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, pick those heels up. Energy.
Yep, this is the important meeting, an aerobics class. And remember, young viewers, this is a movie from 1979, so there's a good chance one of these ladies could be your grandmother. Ugh, this isn't nearly as sexy as the movie thinks it is. To put it lightly...
I'd rather get a table dance from Trent Lott.
Mercifully, her ex-husband, David, pulls her away from the class and back to her office to tell her some important news.
Walter Hines, your business manager, has embezzled all of your money and he has left the country. Okay.
It can't be! Can't be, David! I'm a wealthy woman, you know? I buy what I want. I mean, look at all my stuff. You know, I tip big. If I see a nickel in the street, I don't even stop to pick it up. Does that sound like the behavior of a woman who's broke?
My God, will she ever shut up? So with all of her money embezzled, Hillary is now all but completely broke. However, her old partner had previously purchased the contract of a boxer named Eddie Kid Natural Scanlon, and now that's all she owns. She decides to go down to the gym where he trains to pay him a visit.
Oh, I'm sorry.
I was just looking.
Ah, yes. There's a porno parody of this movie, and this scene is easily the hottest part of it. Or so I've heard. She's told where to find Kid Natural, and she asks a table full of boxers if any of them are the fighter she's looking for.
Which one of you guys is Kid Natural?
I'm Kid Natural.
Hey, what are you talking about, man? I'm Kid Natural.
I'm Kid Natural.
I'm Kid Natural.
I'm Spartacus.
I'm Spartacus.
I'm Spartacus.
I'm Spartacus.
I'm Spartacus.
But the real Kid Natural reveals himself, and it's... Okay, are you serious? Ryan O'Neal? Look, I know the guy used to be a boxer as a teenager, but in 1979, he was 38 years old. This wouldn't bother me so much if his nickname wasn't Kid Natural, but they keep calling him the Kid throughout the whole movie. That'd be like if people called me Blondie. Anyway, Hillary sits down to talk business with the Kid and his trainer, Percy, played by the late Whitman Mayo. They discuss the terms of the contract, which turns out to be nothing but a tax shelter for Eddie.
Very simple. You pay my living expenses, my training expenses, plus a salary of $250 a week, and I guarantee Walter that you lose money.
Huh, just like anybody who paid money to see this movie in the theaters. And before you ask, yes, there were plenty of people who paid to see this in theaters. It made $42 million, making it one of the most successful movies of 1979. But hey, I guess you can't blame the people. It's not like there was anything good showing in theaters, except for maybe Escape from Alcatraz, Meatballs, The China Syndrome, The Jerk, The Muppet Movie, Alien, Apocalypse Now, and Kramer vs. Kramer, just to name a few. Hillary explains her situation to Eddie, and now that she owns his contract, she wants him to do some fighting to earn back some money. But Eddie hasn't had a fight in 4 years, and is not willing to get back into the ring.
I mean, my body could be badly damaged by this. Miss Kramer, do you want my body on your head for the rest of your life?
Well, I've never tried that position before. Wait, what were we talking about?
After she is forced to sell her business, Hillary goes to see Eddie again at his driving academy shaped like a giant boxing glove. The 70s were weird. Hillary continues to hound Eddie about the money he owes her, but he spent it all having his business custom made.
Don't tell me you spent over $60,000 of my money on this.
Didn't you see the glove when you drove up?
Almost immediately.
It was right next door to the little old lady who lived in a shoe.
Eddie tries to ignore her by taking one of his students out for a road test, but Hillary gives chase.
I told you, lady, there is no way I'm going to fight.
Then there's no way I'm going to starve.
Well, I got two words for you, and they are not happy birthday.
Well, I got the same two words for you.
Watch your mouth.
She did. Later, we see Hillary in her apartment when Eddie and Percy come to pay her a visit, and... wait, what the hell? Did she wallpaper over the door? I mean, far be it from me to give advice on interior decorating, but this is goddamn repulsive. Anyway, Eddie explains to Hillary why he doesn't fight anymore.
It was the last time I fought.
Yeah.
Go on. I killed a man. I was at his hospital room. I stayed there for 5 days. I was there when the doctor came and told his wife Billy was gone. At his funeral, I fell to my knees and I swore to his 5-year-old son, I said, I will never again use these messengers of death.
You know, I'm not sure if I believe him or not. Percy, what do you think?
And you expect me to believe a cock and bull story like that?
Yeah, that's what I thought. Hillary knows that he's lying, and she demands that he get back in the ring for a fight. So Percy comes up with the idea of putting him in a fight with a boxer nicknamed the Bleeder. He thinks once Hillary sees all of the blood, she'll be so disgusted that she'll give them the contract back and they'll be free. But right before the fight, their opponent gets changed to someone else. You know what? I don't care about the contract or any of that nonsense. I'm just so happy that we're finally going to see some boxing. So let's get right to the action.
When is he gonna stop feeling sick?
The minute he gets knocked out.
Are you fucking kidding me? They skip over the fight? We are over 30 minutes into this movie, and unless you count some guys in the background in the gym having a sparring match, we haven't seen any boxing yet. I'm not even sure if I should finish this review because it may not qualify as a sports movie. After that cock tease, we see Hillary getting ready to go to a gathering at her ex-husband's place to help promote Eddie. She sits and talks with this girl who I guess is Eddie's on-again, off-again girlfriend, but I don't really know. She's not very well established or important.
What is that fight that never was?
It was the biggest amateur fight of the year. 4 years ago. Pan Am Games.
Mm-hmm.
We were supposed to fight Hector Mantilla, but it never came off.
How come?
They fought outside the dressing room instead. They never got into the ring.
So it was a fight that was being built up and then never happened. Why does that sound so familiar? So Hillary takes Eddie to a party with all of her wealthy friends and tries to shop out shares of his contract.
Although I'm going to be working out of a gym instead of a perfume factory, the kid has the same sweet smell of success.
We find your perfume-related humor most enjoyable.
Later, Eddie is out on the beach, and Hillary comes to tell him the deal was successful, so they have money to keep training him. Eddie is so happy with this news, he starts forcing himself onto Hillary. Okay, so we haven't had any boxing, and now the romance comes, and it's decidedly unromantic. It's not a sports movie, it's not a romance, and it sure as hell isn't funny. So what the hell am I watching? Has this all been one really long PSA about date rape? But Hillary rejects his advances, and the next day he resumes his training, and oh my god, Ryan O'Neal tanked! Ah! Oh my god, oh, I have to scrub this image from my eyes. Okay, so, after the audience gets a face full of balls, Eddie gets knocked around the ring, but a big-time fight promoter, played by the late James Gregory, takes notice of him and Hillary's bantering, and somehow thinks it's marketable. So he gets a fight for Eddie, and after 54 minutes, we finally get to see a boxing match. I guess this means it does qualify for my show, and I can continue with the review. Lucky me. Inside the ring, Hillary raises a concern about the other fighter.
Okay, just one more thing, okay?
Go ahead.
Mr. Cannibal here is wearing, mentholated bomb.
Says who?
Says this.
Must not make those joke will breaking. Okay, I'm good. All right, enough talk. It's time to fight. Oh man, I should have known. The movie has been putting off the boxing this long because they suck at it. I haven't seen boxing this lame since Brawl for All. So, get this. Hillary goes into the ring with a stool, anticipating the end of the round and not wanting to be late with a stool for Eddie to sit on. And of course, this gets Eddie disqualified. This results in some more unfunny banter, which the promoter mistakes as being funny, and he has a meeting with them in his office. Wow, this really is playing out more like a WWE storyline than real boxing. Then again, lately there hasn't been much of a difference between the two. At the meeting, Hillary comes up with the idea of having the fight that never was become a reality once again, wanting Eddie to fight against his old rival, Hector Mantilla. But Eddie takes issue with the idea and pulls her aside.
What do you think I am? A piece of meat? One of your perfumes? You treat me like an object. What do you think I am, a girl?
Shh.
No, I am a person.
Wow. I mean, wow. Even by 1979 standards, that is unbelievably sexist. Again, I ask, where is the romance? These two clearly hate each other. And that translates to real life, too. Ryan O'Neal once said about Barbra Streisand, and I quote, "She is the most pretentious woman the cinema has ever known." Love is in the air. Anyway, Eddie has to win one more fight before they'll give him the big fight against Mantia. And again, it's just as bad as the last fight. Eddie is about to lose, but Hillary dumps a bucket of ice down his shorts, which perks him up enough so that he wins the fight. Afterwards, the promoter tells them he's already set up the match against Mantia at Lake Tahoe. So we then see Hillary, Eddie, and their training crew set up camp at the lake, where Hillary learns she will have to sleep in the bunk cabin with the rest of the men. Oh, hooray! Time for some awkward sexual tension!
Actually,
I was reading in this book.
Oh, thank you.
Tips in the woods. That,
Oh, that's nice.
And by that, I mean rape tension. I seriously fear for this poor woman. I mean, look at her. She's clearly buying time by talking to Eddie before going to bed.
Oh, I'm tired. I got a big day tomorrow. Can't wait to get myself a good night's sleep.
Yeah, me too.
Yeah. Well,
did you know that bears always turn about 90 degrees, and then go about 100 yards downwind before they go to sleep? You see, that way, they can always smell someone coming, you know, if they're being tracked. See, bears have very good noses.
Of course, their noses aren't nearly as sharp as hers. God damn it, movie, you just had to push me, didn't you? And then we get this scene where the threat of rape becomes real when one of the fighters can't stand the scent of her perfume anymore and tries to make his move, needing to be restrained by Percy and the others. This movie fails in so many ways. It fails at being a sports movie, it fails at being romantic, and it damn sure fails at being funny. I find it hard to believe that the threat of rape was ever funny, even by 1979 standards. It's just sick and shameful. The fight is getting closer, and Hillary and Eddie go on TV to promote it, and holy shit, that's Brent Musburger! Wow, okay, that's actually pretty cool that they got a real sportscaster to make an appearance. The movie still blows, though. Anyway, during the interview, Hillary gets cocky and decides to make the fight a winner-takes-all match, to which Mantia agrees. Later that night, as they watch the interview on TV, Hillary falls asleep in Eddie's bed.
You're sitting on a chair.
Yeah.
How come?
Because somebody's sleeping in my bed.
Must be the same one who ate all my porridge! So Eddie, feeling sorry for her, what with the ever-present threat of rape looming over her head, lets her sleep in the bed with him for the night. And yes, this is where they fall for each other.
You know, sex has ruined more fighters and booze.
I hear it can be rough on the owners, too.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. You see, what happens is, it gets them right in the legs.
The next morning, Eddie discusses what the two of them should do after the fight.
Something like a car wash. Or a diner. Something that you can be a big part of, too.
Don't tell me.
I mean, that's just the way it is between husbands and wives.
What are you talking about?
A wedding.
Whose?
Yours.
What, are you asking me to get married?
Yes.
Holy shit, they're really doing this. Yes, because they had one night of sex, Eddie has decided that they need to get married and is offended that Hillary is uncomfortable with the idea. Because, let's face it, every man always wants to marry the woman he just had one night of sex with. That's how you do it, fellas. Every time you have sex with a woman for the first time, propose to her. Sooner or later, you're bound to find one who will say yes. So now that they hate each other again, Eddie plans to win the fight, pay off his debt to Hillary, and then never see her again. At the fight, we see that Eddie is dominating Mantia. While in his corner, Eddie tells Hillary that he's going to knock Mantia out in the next round so they'll never see each other again. He goes back in, and it looks like he's about to deliver on his promise, but Hillary is realizing that she's crazy about him and doesn't want him to leave.
I thought you wanted your money back!
But if he wins, I'll lose him!
You should have let him know!
Oh, I gotta tell him at the end of this round!
There ain't gonna be another round!
I'm coming at the end of the fight!
If he wins, he's not gonna stick around!
But I gotta tell him! I gotta tell him now!
Oh, it's too late, baby! You better send him a letter!
But I gotta tell him fast!
Send me the letter!
So, with that realization, Hillary does the only sensible thing. She throws in the towel to toss the match, giving the victory and all of the prize money to Mantia. Why? So that Eddie will still be in debt to her and have to keep fighting for her. So there you have it, folks. When faced with the choice of living debt-free or living in massive debt with someone you kinda like, always choose the crippling debt. Man, that was bad. The boxing is pathetic, the romance is unbelievable, and the comedy falls flat. It's just a lame movie. Oh, but what Barbra Streisand movie would be complete without a song from Babs?
I'm in love. I gotta thank my lucky star.
But I think we've suffered enough, so to hell with that. So fellas, remember, the next time your girlfriend says she wants to take you to see a sports movie, do yourself a favor and research the movie on IMDb to see what you're getting yourself into. I'm Iannone, and those are the highlights.
Can't wait, I gotta celebrate, it's a fact. We got a first-rate act, it's evident, and we make love.
What is it?
We find your perfume-related humor most enjoyable.
That's disgusting.